Greetings, Prophetess Dawn O'Brien, Sermon of the Lord with Dawn's Heartfelt Corner here. I have a word that I want to share with you. You know, I wasn't planning on doing a word today, you know, but I am a watchman, and a watchman is responsible because if we don't share with you what we know, the Bible says in Ezekiel, the blood is on our hands. So I can't just keep silent and not say anything. Keep warning over and over and over again. And a lot of times I'm just reiterating things that God has already shown me because he wants me to share with you and keep reminding you of what God's word says and to continue to warn you. You know, that's how much God loves you and I. He loves us enough to warn us over and over and over again. But what happens? We're all like that, including myself. We don't listen, okay? And when we don't listen, what happens? Then the Lord is going to discipline us, just like our fathers did when we were younger. And we're about to see God discipline the body of Christ because he's coming back soon for a body without spot or wrinkle. And then he's going to judge the world. So we're getting ready. I'm telling you, something huge is about to take place. Remember, on the 23rd, I give a word, the shaking has started in the United States. And we saw already the Alaska earthquake. That was a big earthquake. And then we had a 5.8 in California on the 25th. We're going to talk about that. And the other day, I said, the storm is headed our way. Seek shelter. Now, seeking shelter means hiding in the shadow of God's wings. You know, I've been persecuted. People are coming at me, and that's okay. We're love them and pray for them. You know, they don't have spiritual eyes to see. They are blinded. And I hate to say it, but many Christians are blind as well. And we're going to talk about that today again. I've been talking about it. That's because Christians are in the world. They're stuck into the things of the world. Jesus said, we're to come out and be separate. Touch no unclean thing and I will receive you. We've talked about that several times. That is a word the Holy Spirit keeps giving me over and over and over again. You know, because he's coming back to get his church. And he wants to make sure that we're right. But we've got a lukewarm church out there. Okay, God talked about in Revelation, there are lukewarm churches out there. And remember, what is getting ready to happen, the Holy Spirit told me he's going to scatter. We're going to see that happen, the scattering of the church. All right, because remember, it talks about it, about, we're going to read that scripture again, about there's going to be a great falling away. Okay, we're going to see that. That's because there are those going to these churches that are listening to false doctrine. They don't know what the Bible says. And they go, oh, good message, because it's tickling the ears. All right, before we get into the preaching, because, you know, I'm already ready to go here. Let's pray. Let's invite the Holy Spirit, the Lord here, and we're going to worship some. So, Father, we just welcome you here to what you're wanting me to say. I yield myself to you and allow you to speak through me slowly and clearly, Lord. Thank you for your strength, Lord. I've been up and down since 2:30 this morning, and yesterday I was up at 3:30. Lord, we just praise you, Lord. You are what helps us keep going, Lord. We couldn't do this without you, Lord. I give you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor, Lord. So I ask that you would have me speak your words, Lord, that would reach to your people and touch those that need to hear, Father, what it is you're wanting me to say, Father. These are the end days, Lord. We know you're coming. Now, I don't know when. One day is like 1,000 years. 1,000 years are like one day. But, Father, we know you are coming. You're coming back for bride without spot or wrinkle, Lord. Get us there, I pray. Father, get us purified, righteous, holy. Do whatever you need to do in us, Lord. We just give our hearts and our lives to you, Lord. We take up our cross today and we follow you completely, wholeheartedly, Lord. I pray for your people, Lord, today that are blind and don't see. Oh, God, take the blinders off their eyes, Lord. Father, there's a world out there that doesn't even know what's getting ready to take place, Lord. We pray for our saved loved ones, those that don't know Christ and come to Jesus. We pray for our families. We pray for even our Christian brothers and sisters that know God. But, Father, they're not even having a relationship with you, Lord. They're, like, stuck in their own world, Lord. I pray, oh, God, that you begin to wake them up, Lord. Shake them up. Shake your people up, Lord. We thank you and we love you and praise you in Jesus' name. Let's worship God this morning at the cross.
Alas, and did my Savior me, and did my sovereign die? Would he devote that same saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
He's ever than
together. I'm Jesus. I know I will. We need you, Lord, every hour of every day, Lord. We need you, Jesus.
No tender voice like thine.
Holy, holy, holy. Worship him, saints. He's holy. God, you're holy. Love you, Lord. We give you praise this morning.
Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, early in the morning, the sun shall rise to thee. Holy, holy, holy.
Lord God Almighty.
I exalt thee.
Thank you.
him say it's praise him. There's no one else worthy as Jesus. When I look into your holiness, I love this. Praise him. One more. Praise you, Jesus. We love you, Lord. Oh, Lord, we love you. Thank you for your presence, Lord. Touch your people today, I pray. May they feel your presence. May they feel your anointing. May they feel your love. Wrap your arms of love around them.
When I look into your holiness, when I gaze into your loveliness, when all things that surround become shadows in the light of you, when I found the joy of reaching your heart, when my will becomes enthroned in your love, when all things that surround become shadows in the light of you, I worship you.
Praise the Lord. I wanted to read you a scripture, but I didn't have time to look it up. I forget where it's at. You know, Jesus is the reason you and I live. We have no reason. Do you hear me? We have no reason to get up in the morning and go here and go there. Vain. It's vain. And you know, unless you've got Jesus, you're living your life in vain. You're going here. You're going there. There's no reason to be here unless God has a reason, and he does. He has a purpose for you and for me. We have to find out what that purpose is. We spend time with the Lord. He will show us. He's got a plan for all of us. We're all here for a reason, you know. And he wants to save people, you know. And so, you know, I just felt led to tell you that. I know there's a scripture. I'm not sure exactly where it is. But let me, I don't want to pull up too many websites because last time we shut this website down. So let me get into what we're going to talk about. Let me give you an encouraging word first here. From Grace for today. I've got so much paperwork going here saying, you know, I'm reiterating things and letting you know what's coming. But I've got a ton of paperwork here. I'm going to read you a little promise out of Grace for today. I'm going to put my glasses on here. Today. We're almost at the end of January. Can you believe the first month of the year is almost over? I'm telling you, time is flying. The time is speeding up. I really truly believe that God is picking up the speed. All right, for today's word, today's 27th, the road ahead. Have I not commanded you, be strong and courageous? Do not be terrified. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Isn't that awesome to know that God is with you and I no matter where we go? That's Joshua 1:9. Many people try to discover the secrets of what the future holds, but nobody really knows what's in store for us. Instead of fretting about the unknown, prepare yourself for any eventuality that God may bring it on your path. To be able to enter the unknown future in hope and trust, positive and living faith in God is imperative. When Christ lives in your heart and in your thoughts, you'll be able to face the future without fear. See, when you have Jesus, you don't need to fear. Perfect love drives out fear. And if you're not doing what you're supposed to do, you know, there are Christians that are not paying attention to the signs of the time. So they're going to be fearful because they're not walking closely to the Lord. And if I'm talking to you, just go to God. Say, God, forgive me and get back on track. And God can use you right where you're at today. Okay. Let me go on here. When Christ lives in your heart and in your thoughts, you'll be able to face the future without fear. You will have the quiet assurance that you will not be confronted by any situation that you and the living Christ will not be able to overcome together. Lord, I rejoice in the knowledge that you hold my life. Amen. In your hands. I trust you in my entire life. Amen. That's a little prayer. You know, for those that don't know, and we're going to just talk right now. For those that don't know, I was in a car accident in 2000. Brain surgery on the right side of my brain. I should have been dead. I'm a walking miracle. So I know that when people wonder, you know, the way I'm talking, my speech impairment, is because I was in a car accident. I was hit by a drunk driver. You can go on our website, www.dawnsheartfeltcorner.org, and you read my Old Testament. I should have been dead, but God left me here for a reason. The paramedic was off duty, and she happened to stop. I was turning purple. It was faster to drive me to the hospital than fly me. And my car got pushed over the median, and they found me flat on the floor. I was, and there must have been an angel in that car that day because the seatbelt had come off. But I'm perfectly fine. No broken bones or anything. You know, I remember having dream after dream. I was unconscious about 4 weeks. You know, but I'm here to tell you, you can't do your life over again. Once you're dead, you are dead. You know, if you're listening to me or you've been listening to me, you know, in fact, I want to share something with you. You know, that's why I said I want to be led by the Holy Spirit. I'm going to share this and then I'm going to talk to you about praying and accepting Christ into your life. You know, because you need to know that your life is very short. We're all here for a minute and gone the next. You know, I don't know if you heard about this. That flu, that's really bad right now. This flu takes an Alabama bride to be 1 week after a diagnosis. She's a year older than me. She's 47. She's a beautiful blonde. Her name is Catherine Action, 47, who planned to marry in the fall. She planned to get married. She died only 1 week after being diagnosed with the flu. See, we make plans. We're making plans to go here, go there, go on vacation. She's planning to get married, but she didn't know she was going to die. See, you don't know when your last day is going to be. It says, a bride-to-be in Alabama was among the latest casualties this week as a serious outbreak of influenza continued to sweep across the United States. Now, in the Bible, it does say you are going to hear of wars, rumors of wars, pestilence, earthquakes, and a famine. Okay, so these are the signs of the times. We are seeing these happen right before our eyes. Catherine, it says, she got the flu on Wednesday. Only a week after being diagnosed, she left behind two kids and a fiance. And that's, it's sad. It's really sad. It says here, I know California was really bad. It says U.S. health officials have called the winter flu outbreak the most severe since 2014-15. During that season, the flu sickened 34 million people and hospitalized 710,000. Florida has endured a spike in flu activity this season, claiming 3 of the 37 children who have died. All right. It's saying it. So I guess Florida has it too. In its weekly flu report, the Florida Department of Health lists 52 flu outbreaks in nursing homes and long-term care facilities last week. Well, I pray God keep it away from our home in Jesus' name. You know, it's going to happen. We're going to see this. These are the signs of the time. But, you know, just like that lady, she didn't know that she was going to die. I mean, we're here one minute, we're gone the next. Nobody knows. You are not promised eternity. Okay, just like I was in that car accident, it happened so fast. You're here one minute and gone the next. I remember I was in a coma and I had dream after dream after dream. I was in something I couldn't get out of. Now, I was born again, but I remember I wanted to do my whole life over again. And once you're dead, you're dead. There is no such thing as reincarnation, coming back and be somebody else. I know there are people that don't even believe you're going to die. They believe once you're dead, you're dead. No, that's not true. Your spirit lives forever. Okay, and you and I can't think on forever terms, okay? But if you're listening to me and you have not given your heart and life to Christ yet, and you're waiting for something, I don't know what you're waiting for. Because if you wait too long, it's going to be too late. I'm going to tell you right now. I told you before, something's going to happen, and there are going to be people on their deathbed, literally on their deathbed, calling out to Jesus. Don't wait for that day. You may not get that opportunity to call on Christ. Do it now. Everyone that calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. I want to pray with you. I want you to pray and mean it in your heart. Don't say it out here because you don't want to go to hell. Say it because you are ready to turn your heart and life over to Christ. You are seeing what's happening and you're like, wait a minute. And you're getting fearful. You don't need to be afraid, okay? God knows everything. This is all planned. It's in Revelation. It's in the Bible. This is going to happen, okay? There is nothing you or I can do to stop it. Okay. All we can do is be ready and take one day at a time and ask God to help me be ready for what's coming. And he will. He promised to take care of you and I. He promised to get us out of here. He said, pray that your word will escape all that's getting ready to come upon this world. Now, this world will be judged. There will be people that will never come to Christ. It doesn't matter what you say or what you do. There are going to be people that will never come to Christ. But there are those still that need to hear the gospel and that will come to Christ. Just like, remember, John the Baptist, prepare ye the way, warning the people, all right? Remember, Noah was out there warning. They were laughing at him. They kept saying, flood's coming. They laughed. And what happened? They all died in the flood. Okay, people are laughing at me. They think this is funny. They think I'm crazy. No, I'm not crazy. The Holy Spirit has shown me things. Okay, it may not be here right this second, but that doesn't mean it's not coming. Okay, one day to the Lord is like 1,000 years. 1,000 years are like one day. That's what the Bible says. It says, no man knows the day or hour. Okay, he's going to come unexpectedly. Okay, you're not going to know. It's just going to happen. Things are going to happen. I believe it's going to happen suddenly. We're going to see things happen suddenly. You know, and people have been hearing the warnings. And I think after a while, people are taking it for granted. And then people say, oh, they've been saying this for years. Christ is coming. You know why God tarries? He's waiting. He's a very patient God. He's taking his time because he wants everyone to come to Christ. He wants you to come to Christ. You're listening to me. You don't know Christ. God wants you to come to Christ. Okay? He's not going to force you. He's not going to twist your arm and say, oh, come to Christ. You know, no. He's going to leave that decision up to you. You have to make a decision. Are you going to give your heart and life to Christ or you're not? There's only two places you can go. And I've said this before. You're either going to go to heaven, up to heaven, or you're going to go to hell. Okay? You're either going to take the broad path or you're going to take the narrow path. Okay? Many travel on the broad path. Remember all those fires that were going on in California? Remember I talked about it. They were driving down the highway, and all the fires were going on. Everyone's traveling down that broad path, you know, but there's a narrow path. God wants you to travel on the narrow path, all right? If you want to come to Christ, I want to pray with you. And, you know, just mean it. Say it out of your heart. Just pray a prayer with me. Bow your head, and I'm going to pray with you. And just repeat this prayer and say, dear Jesus, I'm a sinner. Forgive me of my sins. Cleanse me and wash me in your blood. Come into my heart and save me. I believe you died for me, Jesus, to give me eternal life. I receive you now, Jesus, as my Lord and Savior. Amen, amen. If you said that prayer, go and share the good news. Go tell somebody. This is the happiest day of your life. The angels are rejoicing. Okay, don't just say the prayer now and go off and do your own thing. No, say this prayer. Go ahead and if you're not a subscriber on our YouTube page, go ahead and make a page if you don't have one. There's still room on our Facebook. You can like it. Let us help mentor you, okay? You know, if you can find a good church, there's not many out there that are speaking the truth. You want to hang around other Christians that will encourage you and lift you up in these last days. You want to be hearing the word of God. You want to help grow your Christian walk now. This is just the start. Now, God doesn't expect you to be all know everything all at once. No. You're taking baby steps, okay? And he will be there to help you. He will be there to lead you and guide you. Get yourself a Bible. Do you have a Bible? You know, get yourself some praise music. Get yourself a devotional. Maybe you need to devote for God's promises. We're getting ready to go through the fire. I'm just telling you. A roller coaster ride. I've talked about that before. Up and down. Twists and turns, okay? So you want to be strong in the Lord in these last days. Because we're going to go through hard days. You know, but Jesus will be there to help you, whatever we go through. Okay, I just wanted to share that. Here, let's see if I want to give you some more news before we get into what I want to talk about. There's a lot I want to talk to. I'm like, well, I don't know where to start here. Let's look at these earthquakes. You know, I've given you the link to Dutch. Now, Dutch has been having problems. We need to pray for him because they've been flagging his videos on YouTube because he's speaking the truth, all right? And they think he doesn't know anything, all right? And they're coming at him. I believe it's because they don't want him telling you, warning you of what's coming, okay? Now, I try to listen to him write this down. I don't know everything, but I'm learning just like you are. You know, I really like this earthquake stuff, but I probably should have took a class on it. I really like it. But he's got a video out. I'm going to place it up on Facebook and YouTube. California earthquake unrest. West Pacific large earthquake threat. Okay, he says, I said when Dutch talks about a slow slope, he's referring to the plate moving because that is what the professional said 1 year ago this month, which is today, January 27, 2018. Now, I hope I said it right. I try to listen to him write it down. They said the plate was moving and called it a slow slope. They said the slow slope is slipping, shifting to the north and then to the south. When the cluster of earthquakes stopped, professionals made announcements that the slow slip had stopped, period. That's what they said. In fact, I think that's what happened, I don't know, it was in 2011, then Japan got hit. Okay, so Dutch kept watching the red dots bounce around plate to plate, Pacific to North America. And see, he's saying that, I think the slow slope is stopping. They're not having as many earthquakes. They're having these mini clusters, I think he said. But they haven't been huge. And remember, on January 23rd, I gave a word. The shaking has started in the United States, okay? Alaska had an 8.2 downgraded to a 7.9. On January 25th, California had a 5.8 strikes off Northern California coast, okay? He says here, after the 7.9 earthquake struck up in Alaska a couple days ago, we issued an earthquake warning for the west coast of the United States to watch for a 5.9 earthquake. And then he said that's when the 5.8 plus a 5.1 struck near the warned location in California on the west coast as expected. See, God is showing him things. He's a Christian. God is showing him things, and the enemy is coming against him, all right? He says here, additionally, new volcanic plumes showed up in California and Arizona. And he said, and I said, you can go over to Dutch's website and watch the video on January 25th, 2018. Remember I told you about a lady, she sent lava rocks over there in California on the beaches that there were volcanoes erupting in the ocean, okay? And he has these maps where he can see these plumes that are showing up. And I think he said, somebody said that, oh, these are just farms starting fires, but they're actually plumes. He said, volcanic plumes of smoke that they're seeing. So you need to go over his website. He knows more about it. He's awesome. Go listen to him. I've given you the website for Dutch. You need to go listen to him. All right. And then, yes, the 25th, I give a word. The storm is headed our way. Seek shelter. Now, that was a word the Holy Spirit gave me. And we're going to go back and read these. And we're going to talk about it in a little bit here. But, no, maybe I'll just do it now because I don't want to forget. Remember, I'm just going to mention briefly, about September 29, 2017, a gentleman had sent warnings of a major earthquake coming to California from James Bailey Major. And I give you the link so you can check it. But there was an email that was received from Byron Searley sharing a prophetic warning he recently regarding a major earthquake striking the west coast of the United States. No, I've given warnings. I've told you I woke up at 3 a.m. and said, move away from the west coast. That was back in May 16th, okay? Same day that a press release was made by John L. Casey, who is in charge of the International Volcano Center. He's a scientist. We're going to talk about that in a minute, too. We're reiterating things that I've already talked about. I've spoken with him right here in Orlando, Florida. Well, this gentleman, Byron Surrey, he shared a word about, he was in prayer. He said yesterday, the Lord gave him this word. It was very disturbing as I was given a vision while the Lord was telling me about it. I saw a vision of a northwest earthquake and the Space Needle falling over in Seattle. Then I saw California, what I looked like a crack or splitting running from San Francisco to San Diego. Just opened up and the land on the coast just fell off into the ocean. The Lord says, my son, write these words this day, for it is a day of sorrows. Many people will perish this day, and hell will be enlarged. My mercy will be on the souls who believe in my son, Jesus. Judgment day has come. My son, I have shown you while you are praying what is coming. The northwest will be first, and 9.1 will shake Washington, Oregon with fierceness. Within 24 hours, California will be broken apart by the 12.2, which will cause the separation of the state. Part will fall into the sea and what remains will be shattered. All right. You can go look at this link. I've given it. Warnings from Bob Jones as well. I mean, he talked about San Diego, that he got a vision too. You need to go listen to this. And Rick Joyner, I'm not going to go over all this. Warnings from the Indian gentleman, Sandhu Sundar. Warnings about he received in Costa Mesa, he received for the state of California. I'm not going to read all of it, but you can go and take a look at that. I've already shared this before. All right, let me go back on here. On 12/27, remember, the Holy Spirit told me, tell my people, I'm about to wake them up. Then on 12/5, remember, I saw a vision of a baby being shaken like that. He said that's what he's going to do to the church and to the world. He's going to shake them up, all right? I saw a vision of a baby being shaken that was asleep. Then I looked up baby being shaken, and I had gotten this, all right? It's called shaken baby syndrome. He described it as a resulting from violent shaking or shaking and impacting the head. But God was showing me he's getting ready to do that to the church and the world. He's going to shake it. And now we've talked about this. We've got this super moon blood, blue blood moon that is coming on January 31st, which is running into a Jewish holiday, somebody told me. Okay, we're going to talk about that in a minute. And but remember that dream I had November 14 about the Warning Dream California Hollywood movie. And the prophetic word, move away from the West Coastline, 5/12/17. And David Wilkerson's warnings. He's given many of warnings of God's judgment on America. Now, I've sent letters to President Donald Trump, and I've warned him over and over. I think I've sent, I told you, what was it, 46, 47 letters? And warned him. I told him about I included the warnings from Mr. John L. Casey, who is the CEO of the International Earthquake and Volcano Prediction Center, Okay, remember I told you that he's a former White House space program advisor, NASA headquarters and congressional consultant, and was a senior field engineer on the space shuttle program. All right, he's written books, Dark Winter and the December 12, 2016 book, Upheaval. All right, and he sent an email the same day that the Holy Spirit was giving me a word on the, the same day I gave that word, May 12th at 3 a.m., move away from the West Coast. Same day, he sent a letter to Secretary of Energy Rick Perry. I mean, if that's not God, I don't know what is. I mean, that's, the Holy Spirit was showing me that. It was like, boom. And then I've actually talked with him a few times. Okay? Okay, he said this warning, the imminent threat to U.S. energy resources and nuclear facilities that their team of scientists detected from years of accumulated research. Okay, we've talked about this, okay? Now, he said, our estimates of the damage that could strike as soon as tomorrow indicate that many millions of Americans could experience earthquakes so large that whole states and regions of the country could be without water and power for weeks or months at a time. And they're saying that the research demonstrates that multiple big ones are about to sweep across the U.S. between 2017 and 2038. As history shows, it's happened before. Okay? They said we should prepare. Well, we're doing nothing. I'm going to tell you right now. We're doing nothing. Okay? And I said, you know, he's got a survey out. President Donald Trump, if you're listening to me, I want you to know we love you. Okay? We believe God placed you in office for such a time as this. But I'm going to tell you something, and I say it out loud, because the Bible says wounds from a friend can be trusted. You know, you've got those spiritual advisors there. They're supposed to give you advice. They're supposed to be telling you, helping you, all right? And they're doing nothing. They're just saying, oh, you're doing a good job, which he is, okay? And I've said this many times. When it comes to the business world, Donald Trump knows what he's doing. But remember, when it comes to spiritual, God said we're to be wise like the serpent and innocent as doves. Okay. Now, I know President Donald Trump is very bold. And he says whatever is on his mind. No, I'm like that too. So I'm not going to knock him. But we need to watch our words in these last days, because our words will get us in trouble. All right. But he has a thing that says they hate fake news. Well, if we hate fake news, why aren't we letting anyone know about these earthquakes that are happening? They're getting bigger now in the United States. What about these volcanoes? Why are we giving, like, Dutch a hard time? The USGS trying to downgrade, not telling you nothing. Why are we not telling nobody nothing? I know we don't want to get people panicking, but we need to start preparing and getting back to God. Because I'll tell you right now, if we do not start getting to God, we're going to have problems. I'm going to tell you right now, problems like we've never seen, all right? We've got people and other nations threatening America, wars, rumors of wars, North Korea, Russia, China. Everybody's trying to sneak around, spy planes and things. I mean, what is all that about? Everyone wants to get a nuke. They want to blow us up. I'm telling you right now, they don't like America. We got the, here we are getting our nose in between the, we're going to talk about this too, the Palestinians. What are we doing trying to make peace with the Palestinians and Israel? I mean, come on. Where the virus should be telling President Trump, stay out of that. Don't have nothing to do with that. Because, you know, every time we get our nose into something like that, watch out. Because we're not to mess with Israel. All right? We're not to mess. All the countries have turned on Israel. But this is all biblical prophecy. All right? So we're not going to stop it, because God said it was going to happen. All right? So I said, we're not talking about the earthquakes that are happening, all right? What about the dead fish, birds, mammals, changes in the sun? What about all these asteroids, near-Earth objects, meteorites that are just flying by and nobody's saying nothing? And then there's ones that come, nobody knows anything until last minute, and NASA don't tell you. They don't want you to know what's happening, all right? They don't want us to know, but we have to be aware. We have to be vigilant in these last days. I'm going to tell you, Steve. If they're not going to tell us, you've got to be ready. And I'm not saying be fearful or worried. You know, my girlfriend thinks, well, this is all I do. No, I'm a watchman. This is the calling that God's placed on my heart. We're to watch, pray, and know the times that we're living in. Not just do what I want, go here, go there, plan our own life, and act like nothing's going on. That's not how we're to be. God wants us prepared because things are going to change. I'm going to tell you right now, we need to be ready. What about all the major floods, tornadoes, cosmic rays coming close to Earth, wars and rumors of wars? Why is America not making preparations for safeguarding our country for this new era of geophysical danger? I said to him. All right. What are we doing for our nation to protect it in the loss of power and water? And what about feeding all the people? What are we going to do? The food. The birds are dying. Whales. The fish are dying. I mean, what are we going to do? Okay. And then we got President Donald Trump. Remember when Texas had the flood? Oh, we want everyone to pray to their God. You know, it's not whatever God you want to pray to. If you remember, those false prophets were calling on their Baal. And guess what? Their Baal did not answer. It was Elijah that called upon his Lord. And guess what? He showed up. So it's not whatever God you want to call upon. And what about those advisors? They're not saying nothing. They have that one pastor up there praying, if my people will humble themselves, and leaves off the most important verse that says, turn from their wicked ways. Has America turned from its wicked ways? No. I mean, come on. We've got pastors, advisors that don't even tell them what's right. You know what? I'd be like Donald Trump. Remember, he said, you're all fired. That's what I'd say. You're fired. You know, because that's what he would do. If you're not going to do your job, you're fired. If you're called to do something, you better do it unto God. That goes for all of us. If God has given us a job to do, then we better do it unto the Lord. He sees. Man may not see, but God Almighty sees. He sees what's being done behind closed doors, and he's going to bless you when you do what you're told to do. All right? It doesn't matter whether man sees or not. God Almighty sees. All right? All right, so the administration is focusing its attention on producing more jobs without them growing the economy. And we're worried about politics. I'm going to just tell you, I don't get into politics. I don't have time for that. I don't want to get upset and get mad. You know, President Donald Trump, we need to not get on politics because this is what's important. And it's going to affect America if we don't start paying attention to what is happening. It's going to catch us off guard. That's what the enemy wants. He wants to catch us off guard. And that's what he's going to do in these last days. He comes in, cunning serpent, to deceive. And he's going to catch us off guard. And that's what's even happening in the churches today. They're listening to this preacher saying, oh, good message. But it ain't lining up with the word of God. And they're being deceived. That's what's happening. And that's what's going to happen in these last days. All right, so I sent this letter. I've sent several letters to him. I said, we need to warn the people of what's going on. All right? I said, why aren't we warning and saying anything to the public? You say you have fake news, but Mr. President, we're not informing the people. Everything is being kept in the dark. I told him we need to warn the people what's happening in our nation and world. This needs to be spoken on national news. I said, I'm not a woman entrepreneur. I'm a woman prophetess. You know, because I told you, I saw that he had a video where there were women entrepreneurs. I said, well, I'm not an entrepreneur. And I said, I'm a woman prophetess. The Lord gave that to me. God reveals to me the dangers that are upon us as a nation and world, I said. Woman entrepreneur is a person who organizes and manages any enterprise. I want to be a prophetic voice, and I've said that to God years ago. I want to be a prophetic voice, organize, manage, and set up preparations to safeguard our nation in the new era geophysical danger that is upon us. We as a nation must prepare and get ready for the hard days that are ahead of us. If we don't start precautions now, there'll be no economy. Well, for prosperity for the American people, and I've told you before, we're going to see an economic collapse, and it's going to happen. Boom, suddenly. David Wilkerson talked about it. It's going to happen suddenly. And I said, it stands in my heart, mostly God, that we have ignored what he's showing us. The calm before the storm. All right. The CEO, John L. Casey, he had wrote me back in June, and he said, since your approach is religious and mine is scientific, he said, because he's a scientist, in our own separate ways, perhaps we can get the government's attention. My prayer is that someone in the White House, I said, will pay attention to the signs all around before it's too late. The lives of the American citizens are at stake. Thank you, and God bless you. Now they are. I'm going to tell you right now, we're getting ready to see something take place. All right, so we talked about those earthquakes. Let's get back over here to what I want to talk about now. All right, this one is called "You, My Child, Have Reached the End." Well, I'm sorry, I've got two words. I'm going to give you the good one first, all right? I've got a lot to talk about. I wasn't going to share this and then the other day, and I said, well, now I got two I got to share with you. So I'm going to share two, okay? But this is the good one before I get into the other one because that's more lengthy. "You, My Child, Have Reached the End." And this, the Holy Spirit gave to me, which I know He wants me to share with you as well. There are those I know waiting on the Lord for God to open doors for them. God has a plan and He has a purpose. Okay? And I heard Him say this to me. "You, My Child, Have Reached the End. My child, you've arrived at the end of what I planned for you. Your destiny," I hear the Lord say. Amen. Jeremiah 1:5, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations." Jeremiah 29:11, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope." Doors are about to open, praise God, says the Lord. Keep waiting and trust me. Do not give up. Get tired and quit. Your end shall be great, I hear the Lord say. Your end shall be great, praise God. Job 8:7 is another verse. If you've got a Bible, you want to look at these with me, or you have a pen and paper, you want to jot them down. Job 8:7, "Though your beginning was small, yet your later end would increase abundantly. Others have written you off." And that's what he said to me. "Others have written you off and have said, you are out of your mind." People have said that to you. I know they think I'm crazy. All right. "Daughter and son, you are not crazy." Hallelujah. "The vision will speak for itself." That's right. Is God giving you a vision? Hold on to that vision. "The vision will speak for itself. Though the vision tarries, keep waiting for it, says the Lord. It shall come forth in due time." And I've read this. I told you, if you don't have it, you need to read it. Because I read it pretty much every day. You know, it helps to keep encouraged in the Lord. Habakkuk 2:2-3. "The just live by faith. Then the Lord answered me and said, write the vision." So write it down and make it plain on tablets that he may run who reads it. "For the vision is yet for an appointed time. But at the end it will speak and will not lie. Though it tarry," see it tearing, "wait for it. Because it will surely come, it will not tarry." You must believe and have faith as small as a mustard seed. That's right. I heard the Holy Spirit say that. Matthew 17:20. So Jesus said that because of your unbelief, for surely I say to you, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you. Amen. "I will open the windows in heaven and pour forth my blessings upon you that will be too much for you to carry. Abundant blessings are coming your way." I heard him say that. Abundant blessings are coming your way. "You have been faithful to me, sons and daughters of the Most High. Now I, the Lord, promise to be faithful to you. All my promises are yea and amen." 2 Corinthians 1:20. "For no matter how many promises God has made, they are yes in Christ, and so through him the amen is spoken by us to the glory of God." "Do not doubt my goodness anymore, children." I don't know about you, but I know that God's going to move. But, you know, sometimes we're like, God, I know I heard you, but when, God, when, you know. So he doesn't want you and I to doubt his goodness anymore. James 1:5-6 says, "If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God who gives all liberally and without reproach, and will give it to him. But let him ask in faith with no doubting." That's James 1:5-6. "For he who doubts is like a wave of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind." So God does not want you and I to doubt. Go and take a listen to these videos. I did Miracle Making Time. There are babies being born in the spirit. Remember, we talked about that. God gave this morning to me, and it was powerful. You're about to see a baby born in the spirit. And he gave me a word. I'm about to set the captives free. And do not doubt God's goodness. My child, do not lose heart. Go listen to these messages. It will encourage your heart. You know, I'm going to see how many I can place it. If not, like I said, make yourself a website on our YouTube so you can go take a listen to them. Now, I'm not going to read you about doubting Thomas, but you know, the Lord told him, right here, where you can read it, John 20, 24 through 29, Jesus and Thomas. He told him to put his finger in his side, okay, because he was doubting here. It's real short. Now, Thomas, one of the 12 called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So their disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands a mark of the nails, and place my finger into the mark of the nails, and place my hand into the side, I will never believe." 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Verse 27, then he said to Thomas, put your finger here and see my hands, and put your hand and place it in the side. Do not disbelieve, but believe. Now, I'm just stopping here because I'm thinking that, you know, let's see. Now, Thomas, when this will count. See, I got to stop this because I got to talk about this. I'm going to go back here. It says, now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." Now, isn't this something? I've thought about this. Jesus was not with Thomas when he said, "Unless I see his hands, the mark of his nails, and place my finger into the mark of the nails, and place my hand in the side, I will never believe." But isn't that something? God heard him. I just saw that. You know, he wasn't with Thomas, but he heard what Thomas said. I said, wow, you know, see, that's what it tells you. You know, God knows everything. He hears you and I whenever we cry out to him. You know, or there are times I'm looking for something. He hears us, saints. He knows only hairs are on our head. He knows everything. See, he heard Thomas when he said, "Unless I see this, I will never believe." Okay, but then when he came and met with them, he said, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and put your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." And then he said, "My Lord and my God," Thomas said. Jesus said, "Have you believed because you've seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen yet have believed." See, so we're blessed that have never seen the Lord. Hallelujah. The Lord just showed me that. Praise God. All right, have faith is what he said. "Then your reward shall be great a little while longer, and I will come to take you away. There are those that do not believe. I have a set time, but I, the Lord, do, and my timing is perfect." Hallelujah. "Everything is planned according to my will and purpose. I promise not to be one day late. You must fight the good fight of faith and stay encouraged, saints. Encourage your brother and sister in the Lord as you see the day approaching." So we need to be encouraging one another. As we see the day approaching, we have to encourage one another. Hebrews 10, 24 through 25 says that. "And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another. And all the more as you see the day approaching." He said, do not be faint. That's right. Don't be faint. Bear up under all circumstances. This is the day the Lord has made. Rejoice and be glad in it. So we need to rejoice. God's made this day. We need to rejoice. God's given you and I everything. What more can we ask for? He's given us salvation. That's the best gift of all. I'm telling you right now, we're not going to hell. So we've got a lot to be thankful for. "Do not be weary in well-doing, for the Lord has spoken." He gave me Galatians 6, 9 through 10. I'm reading you from the Passion Translation. Galatians 6, 9 through 10. "And don't allow yourselves to be weary or disheartened in planting good seeds. For the season of reaping the wonderful harvest you planted is coming. Take advantage of every opportunity to be a blessing to others, especially to our brothers and sisters in the family of faith." All right. That's the first word that I want to share with you. Let me now I want to share this word with you, and then we're gonna stop and read some news too with this. I've got some scriptures I want to read to you. If you have a Bible, you need to go grab it. We're going to read it, some scriptures, or you want to jot down. Now, I may not read every scripture. I've said it before. You know, you're going to have to study for yourself, saints. The Bible says in Hosea, my people die for lack of knowledge. So you're going to have to start reading the Bible and studying scriptures on your own. I cannot read every scripture. You know, it's not that I don't want to. It's just, you know, as I get busier and busier, which I know I'm going to be, you know, I'm on here already a couple hours at a time. But, I feel there may be times later in the future, there may be all-day services. I don't know. I got a feeling things are going to change. All right. So, this was a word I got today. Now, I told you I was up early today, a little 2:13. I was up early, and then I was up early yesterday. And, now, I don't feel this dream had anything to do with anything, okay? Now, if anyone has an interpretation or they feel, you know, God was showing you something, you can share with me. You know, I feel this may have been God just trying to wake me up, you know, because I don't dream about bugs. I'm going to tell you right now, I don't like bugs, all right? And we don't have any bugs that we spray in here. And sometimes in my hair, I'll read it to you. Okay, at 2:13 a.m., I woke up from a dream with a crawling bug that looked something like a roach, but it wasn't a roach. It had wings, all right, by a salad on a picnic table. Okay, this is what I saw. I don't know what this is. I went to go get more salad, and this lady said the salad were in the cups. You know, they had cups put out with salad that was in there. I told them there were none. She said, you have to put a towel on the table. And when I did, I kept seeing a few. I didn't see a lot. I saw a few of these roaches or whatever they were with wings, you know, that kept coming near the salad. I said, I didn't know roaches ate salad. Then I woke and looked on my bed because sometimes you feel something crawling on you while you're sleeping. I think it's real. And I said, it may have been my hair, you know, because sometimes my hair makes me itch. And I have to admit, sometimes I get these little ants. We've got ant traps trying to get the ants, but they're not in the bedroom. And I don't see roaches ever in there. So I didn't know what was crawling on me. So if you've got, if God's giving you some interpretation, I believe that was God's way of waking me up. Okay, that's what I feel. Because he has a way of waking me up. There's been times I've coughed suddenly, and then I'm getting up. So I know God wakes me up. He has a way of getting my attention. So that's what I feel. It was just waking me up. All right. So I said, went to the restroom, and when I laid back down, I heard the Holy Spirit say this to me. The hour is near. I heard him say that to me. All right. I'm calling this word, the hour of trial is upon you. And this is what I got. Wake up, O sleeper, and rise from the dead, and Christ will shine upon you. Ephesians 5:14. This is why it said, wake up, O sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Fierce darkness. I heard this. Fierce darkness has come over the earth. I see the sky getting darker and changing color. Now, could this happen to be something that has to do with that supermoon? Now, hey, I don't know. You know, we're supposed to have more than one supermoon in these next few years, I believe. So I don't know if this is something that's going to happen now or if it's something in the future. I don't know, okay? But that's what I heard him say. Fierce darkness has come over the earth. I see the sky getting darker and changing color. Okay, this super blood moon that is getting ready to happen, let me read you, is going to be on a Jewish holiday, I heard. It's called, I'm not good at pronouncing words, Tu B'Shabbat, I don't know, I can't speak, I want to take a Hebrew class, Shabbat. It says that it begins on sunset on January 30th and ends at nightfall on January 31st, okay? It means literally New Year of the Trees. It says, in contemporary Israel, the day is celebrated as an ecological awareness day and trees are planted in celebration. But so it is some type of holiday in Israel. Okay. And I told you, let me read you about the blood moon here. All right. There's a blue blood moon. It has prophetic significance, which I told you the other day. The religious leaders are saying. Okay. The super blue blood moon is going to be on January 31st. Super moons occur when the moon is closer to the earth in its rotation, making it appear bigger than usual. The moon will appear up to 14% bigger and 30% brighter. The moon appears blue due to earth's dark shadow. Now this rabbi from King David's tomb on Mount Zion, he believes the super moon's ending with the blue blood moon has special significance in light of current world events having to do with Israel. Now, recently President Trump announced that the U.S. would recognize Jerusalem as the capital of Israel and that the U.S. would move its Israel embassy there. Okay, and we know that the Palestinians are not happy about that. All right, now I want to read you this article. I'm going to put this up too. It's by Dabu. All right. He's gotten there. President Donald Trump accuses Palestine of disrespecting the United States. America should not even be involved with trying to make peace talks with the Palestinians. The Christian advisor of the Trump administration ought to be giving him advice. This is biblical prophecy being fulfilled, and we cannot stop what God has planned. And we can't. It's in the Bible. Anyone who tries to separate Israel's land, God will bring judgment upon. This is a very, very dangerous, serious matter. And we've seen things happen, not huge, but we've seen things happen every time we've tried to do something with Israel. The Bible clearly states, Joel 3:2, I will gather all the nations and bring them down to the valley of Jehoshaphat. Then I'll enter into judgment with them there on behalf of my people and my inheritance. Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations, and they've divided up my land. Now remember, was it Nikki Haley? She went to the UN, and somebody asked her a question, and she said, we're not going to help the Palestinians unless they come to the table and make peace talks. Well, we shouldn't even be trying to make peace talks. Why were we even helping them? That started with Obama. He was giving them money and helping them. Okay, and remember, I did a prophetic word on 1-3-2008, I woke up at early in the morning at 4:30 a.m. and I said, you're trying to divide Israel, my nation. I will divide you. And, you know, that goes along with the three prophetic words, which I didn't read all of them, about warnings of a major earthquake coming to California. I believe, this is what I believe, there's going to be right up California. God's going to divide it. Something's going to happen. We need to pray, saints. All right, and you can look at all that. There's another article in here. Donald Trump accuses Palestine of disrespecting the U.S. to blow to peace talks. And you can look at that and all these videos that I have on here. Okay, let's let me go over to the earthquakes and see what's going on with these earthquakes right now. I've given you the link. I'm not going to read all of them. Alaska's got small swarms. California at 2.7 2 hours ago, 3.4 in Alaska 2 hours ago, 4.7 in Honduras 3 hours ago, 3.3 in Alaska 3 hours ago. You know, I've told you things can happen just like that. We've seen it already. All right. Could we see the Ring of Fire earthquakes? That could be getting ready to happen with the super blue blood moon. There was a Hawaii volcano 1.8 3 hours ago, 3.1 Alaska, 3.7 Alaska 4 hours ago. 3.0 5 hours ago in Alaska, 3.4 in California 5 hours ago, Iran at 4.1 5 hours ago, 4.1 again Iran 5 hours ago, Alaska 2.5 5 hours ago, small storms still going on, Alaska, California, 4.6 Alaska 6 hours ago, 4.0 Alaska 6 hours ago. Sir Omen, where I don't know where that is, 4.36 hours ago. the Dominican Republic 2.96 hours ago. 2.7 Alaska, 8 hours ago. 4.2 in Chile, 8 hours ago. 4.0 in Alaska, 9 hours ago. 4.3 in Alaska. That was 9 hours ago. They're still getting a lot. Puerto Rico had a 2.9 10 hours ago. And these are just Alaska and California. 4.7 Fiji region, 12 hours ago. All right, so you can take a look at that map. Now, I want to read you this Ditronum. I think I put up a link for the website on this video I'm putting up from Dutch. He has on there a 6-point earthquake San Francisco any time now. Statistics say. This is what he's saying, and I'm going to read this to you. According to statistics, I can't get the word out. According to statistics, based on the last 180 years, we're overdue for a magnitude 6.5 earthquake in the San Francisco Bay Area, is what he's saying. Every 7-plus magnitude earthquake was followed by 24 to 27 years quiet period, after which a magnitude 6.5 earthquake struck. The only exception was the magnitude 7.8 earthquake in 1906, which shook out so much stress that a 68-year quiet period followed. But in the 1979, a new series of 6-pointers started, peaking magnitude 7 in 1989. This is now almost 29 years ago, is what he's saying. This means that a magnitude 6.5 plus earthquake can strike any time. And he's giving major earthquake warning February 21st through March 7th, 2018. Okay, I just wanted to share that with you of what he had to say. All right, let's get back to what we're talking about here. Okay, so we see what's happening with Israel, all right? I believe, you know, I've heard whenever something happens with Israel, it's going to happen in the United States. So something is getting ready to happen. Let me read, Joel chapter 2. I don't even know where it's at. I don't know where everything is at, saints. I'm learning like you are. You know, God takes the weak things of the world and confounds the wise. Isn't that awesome that he can use any of us? You know, he's looking at our heart. 14:12. Let me find it. Joel 2. If you want to turn to it with me, let's see. Give me a minute. All these small books in the Bible, I don't know where everything's at. All right. Almost there. Let's see. All right. Got all these notes. I hope I don't drop them. I don't know. I got all this paperwork here. Yeah. All right. We're going to read Joel 2. Blow the trumpet in Zion. Sound the alarm on my holy hill. Let all who live in the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming. It is close at hand, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and blackness. Like dawn spreading across the mountains, a large and mighty army comes, such as never was of old nor ever will be in ages to come. So what's coming has never been heard of. We're about to see something. Before them, fire devours. Behind them, a flame blazes. Before them, the land is like the Garden of Eden. Behind them, a desert waste. Nothing escapes them. They have the appearance of horses that gallop along like cavalry. With a noise like that of chariots, they leap over the mountaintops, like a crackling fire consuming stubble, like a mighty army drawn up for battle. At the sight of them, nations are in anguish. Every face turns pale. They charge like warriors, they scale like walls, like soldiers. They all march in line, not swerving from their course. They do not jostle each other. Each marches straight ahead. They plunge through defenses without breaking ranks. They rush upon the city. They run along the wall. They climb into the houses like thieves. They enter through the windows. Before them, the earth shakes. The sky trembles. The sun and moon are darkened, and the stars no longer shine. The Lord thunders at the head of his army. His forces are beyond number, and mighty are those who obey his command. The day of the Lord is great. It is dreadful. Who can endure it? I'm learning like you. Rend your heart. Verse 12. Even now, declares the Lord, return with all your heart, with fasting and weeping and mourning. See, it's time that we turn to the Lord. Rend your heart and do not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for he's gracious and compassionate. Slow to anger and abounding love, and he relents from sending calamity. Who knows, he may turn and have pity and leave behind a blessing, grain offerings and drink offerings for the Lord your God. I am reading the right thing, right? Okay. This is lengthy. Let me, I can't find everything in this Bible. I told you, I got how many different Bibles. I don't understand all of this. I'm just going to be honest. The Holy Spirit, I need him to teach me because I don't understand it all. And I don't think a lot of people understand it. Okay, let's skip down to verse 28. And afterward, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions, even on my servants, both men and women. I will pour out my spirit in those days. I will show wonders in the heavens and on the earth, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And everyone calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. From Mount Zion and in Jerusalem there will be deliverance, as the Lord has said, among the survivors whom the Lord calls. Now, are we going to see some with this blood moon? I don't know. I'm just saying. You know, I believe we're going to see something one of these blood moons. It may not be this one, but we're going to see something soon. I really believe that. All right. We are seeing the signs of the times changing right before our eyes. All right. You can read it. I'm not going to read it. Matthew 24:3-31. Signs of the age. We've read it before. I'm not going to read all of it. Matthew 24:3-31. Many of my children cannot see what I, the Lord, am doing because they are sleeping, I heard him say. You know, they're looking for a sign. Matthew 16:1-4 says, then the Pharisees and Sadducees came and testing him asked that he would show them a sign from heaven. Verse 2, he answered and said to them, when it is evening, you say it will be fair weather, for the sky is red, and in the morning it will be foul weather. Today, for the sky is red and threatening. Hypocrites, you know how to discern the face of the sky, but you can't discern the signs of the times. A wicked and adulterous generation seeks after a sign, and no sign shall be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. And he left them and departed. I said, why are the Christians sleeping and do not perceive the signs of the times? And I will tell you why. They are in the world. That's right. He showed me that today. Jesus said, come out and be separate. Touch no unclean thing and I'll receive you. That's in 2 Corinthians 6:17-18. 2 Corinthians 6:17-18. Therefore, come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. Do not touch what is unclean, I will receive you. I will be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. I'll tell you what else Jesus said. I know people want to hear this. Oh, wow. I'm not here to please you. I'm here to please my Father. I'm reading you God's word, so don't get mad at me. If you want to get mad at anybody, you need to get mad at God. Don't get mad at me, because I didn't write the Bible. Okay, I'm going to tell you what else Jesus said. Do not love the world. We've talked about that before. Anyone that loves the world has no part in me. Now, I didn't say that, so don't get mad at me. All right? Do not, and I said, don't get mad at me. He said in 1 John 2:15, 17, do not love the world. Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the love of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life is not of the Father, but it's of the world. And the world is passing away. Our world is passing away. I'm telling you right now, it is. And the lust of it, but he who does the will of God abides forever. What's going to happen is this, I said. Remember Lot's wife. She turned back and became a pillar of salt. Remember the disciples that walked with Jesus. They all left him except the 12. They did not stay. They said his teaching was too hard. All right? Peter said this, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Also, we have come to believe and know that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus answered them, did I not choose you, the 12? See, many are going to flee. They're going to go away. They're not going to follow the Lord. You can read that, verse 4, John 6, 60 through 68. Many disciples turn away. Therefore, many disciples, when they heard this, said, this is a hard thing. Who can understand it? Remember, they turned away. So you can read it, John 6, 60 through 68. All right. And remember, I spoke this word just on the 25th. The storm is headed our way. Seek shelter. In that prophetic word, I said this. This storm that is headed our way is what will divide my sheep, I heard him say. They will be scattered, he said. I'm telling you in advance before the storm hits, so you, my children, will be strong for the hard days ahead. No, this does not mean we're going home. I know there are others on YouTube saying, oh, we're going home. Jesus is coming to get us out of here. No, I don't feel that. The Holy Spirit has been getting Daniel and I ready, prepared, for over 20-something years. And I know it's not just to go home. I don't believe we're going to be here a long time. But I do believe the time that we're here is going to be powerful. Because God is getting ready to use them. And he's going to use you too. There are those God wants to use because a great big revival is coming. Alright? So if you are following God and doing what he's asking you to do, taking up your cross and following Christ, then you're getting prepared for what's ahead. God is getting ready to use you. There are those he's going to use in these last days. Okay? Remember you're talking about those going to those churches that are preaching false doctrine. They're going to be the ones scattered, all right? Those that are listening to false doctrine, going where their itchy ears want to go, they're going to be the ones that are scattered. John 10, you can read John 10, 1 through 18, and read 2 Thessalonians 2, 1 through 3, the great apostasy. Let me see. I'm not going to read it all. I just read it the other day about, remember we talked about this, the shepherd that's that is over the sheep. Okay? They're a hired hand. They weren't called from God. They were hired. And so they're there just to make a wage. And that what's going to happen is the people are going to be scattered. These are the ones that are going to those churches. You can read it in John 10, 1 through 18. 2 Thessalonians 2, 1, 3 says, now, brethren, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him, we ask you not to be soon shaken in mind or troubled, either by spirit or by the word or by letter, as if for us as though the day of Christ had come. Let no one deceive you by any means, for that day will not come unless the falling away comes first. See, that's what we're getting ready to see. And the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition. Now, are we going to see the son of perdition? It sounds to me like we may see him. I don't know. We have to watch and see what God's going to do. Okay, they're listening to false doctrine being preached. I've said that. 2 Timothy 4, 3-4. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but according to their own desires, because they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers, and they will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned aside to fables. And we're already seeing that. People don't want to hear the truth. So they're turning away from hearing the true gospel. Those Christians, I said, sitting in the churches with the shepherd is only a hired hand, not a true shepherd. These Christians are going to fall away and be scattered. They're listening to a different type of gospel. See, that's what's happening in these churches. They're not hearing about the Jesus you and I know. They're hearing about a different Jesus, okay? Being preached, the Bible talks about Paul said they believe another Jesus. 2 Corinthians 11, 1 through 4, Amplified Bible. Paul defends his apostleship. I wish you would bear with me while I indulge in a little foolishness. But indeed, you are bearing with me as you read this. I'm jealous for you with a godly jealousy, because I promised you to one husband to present you as a pure virgin to Christ. But I'm afraid that even as the serpent beguiled Eve by his cunning, your mind may be corrupted and led away from the simplicity of your sincere and pure devotion to Christ. For you seem willing to allow it. If one comes and preaches another Jesus, whom we have not preached, or if you receive a different spirit from the one you received, or a different gospel from the one you accepted, you tolerate it as beautifully, welcoming the deception. And it's true. I mean, people give gifts to those ministers that are preaching false doctrine. Here, Daniel and I, nobody helps Daniel and I. I mean, I'm just being honest, okay? We give money to those ministers that are preaching false doctrine because they're tickling our ears. I'm going to tell you the truth. I'm not going to lie to you. I'm going to tell you right now. When I get on here, I'm not going to lie to you. Remember, I told you for New Year's, everyone had this blessing message. I told you what God said to me. I said, God, everyone has a blessing message. You haven't said nothing to me. He said, my winnowing fork is in my hand, and I'm getting ready to clear my threshing floor. I was like, wow. And you know, clear my threshing floor. I was looking up threshing, and it means shake. You know, that was not no blessing message. So I'm not going to get on and tell you that. Oh, God's going to bless you. You can live and do this and do that, and God's just going to bless you. No, just to get your money? No. Because God takes care of Daniel and I. Yes, he's going to use you. Because I really believe the Holy Spirit is going to wake some of you up. Some of you are actually sitting in those churches, giving your money to those false preachers and teachers and prophets that are doing nothing for you. And I'm going to tell you right now, hard days are coming. They're not going to help you. They're not going to encourage you. Those pastors in those churches, they don't have your heart in mind. They don't care nothing about you. They want your money, okay? Start giving your money to those that are speaking the truth. And I'm not saying just our ministry, okay? But you want to be planting your seed where you know that it's going to produce a harvest. If you see God's going to use that ministry, then you want to make sure you're giving your tithe offering into that ministry. All right? And if anyone wants to help us, you can send a gift to Dawn's Heartfelt Corner, P.O. Box 161273, Altamont Springs, Florida 32716. You can give a gift online. It will come directly to us at www.dawnsheartfeltcorner.org. Now, if you want to give a PayPal donation, people have asked for my email, heartfeltcorner10@gmail.com. That's the same email. So you can send us a comment or a prayer need. You can put it on Facebook. You can put it on YouTube. But it's heartfeltcorner10@gmail.com. That is our email, and that is our PayPal for donation. If you have a large gift you want to send, if you'll write on there and let us know, we can send you out a receipt. We are a 501 tax deductible ministry. Go on our YouTube. There are different ways you can give. It's all on there on the ballot screen. It will tell you. Now you can give through Patreon. You can give just $1 a month and help us. You can give a gift through GoFundMe account. There are different ways, you know. And we're not into your money. We're into doing what God's called us to do. We're going to be traveling one of these days. We're waiting on the Lord to open the doors. And those doors are about open. Daniel is almost sealed. Now we don't understand. God is doing things we don't understand. We're like, okay, God, we're trusting you. We're walking blindly. But God has provided and taken care of us. It may not be the way we want it, and it's not going to be the way you want it in the future. He promised to meet our needs, not our wants. So there's a difference. A want is different than a need, okay? If we have food and clothing, Paul said we should be content. Now, I'm like, God, I'm not there yet. Are you? We should be content. We have food and clothing. We have a lot to be thankful for. We got a roof over us. I complain too. We have a roof. We have food. I mean, we have clothes. I mean, our daily needs are met. I mean, what more can we want in America? But what do we say? We want more money, more pay, want this, we want that. We're not satisfied. And it's time we start getting satisfied. Start thanking God, praising God, because I'm going to tell you right now, He's going to take it all away. Then we're going to be crying. We're going to be on our knees crying out to God. Help me, Lord, help me. That's what's going to happen. All right, let me get back to this now. So those people that are going to those false churches, those churches are speaking false doctrine. They're not being built on the solid rock. Remember, I told you, it's time we get our churches built on the solid rock, Christ Jesus. Not on sinking sand, because what's going to happen? We're just going to collapse. We want to be built upon the rock, Christ Jesus. All right? Matthew 7, 24 through 27. I've read it before. All right? We're going to talk about this. And remember I talked about you're not going to cave. Remember I said that? You're not going to cave and fall. And remember why? Because you're built on the solid rock, Christ Jesus. See, if you're built on the rock, you're not going to cave in. You're going to be able to mount up on wings like the eagles and soar above life's problems. I've read before, Matthew 7, 24 through 27. Build on the rock. It's so important, saints. You build your house, your temple, on the rock. Start reading the Word of God. Start getting yourself built up so that you will be strong in the days ahead. If you're not built up and you're not strong, you're not going to have the Word coming out of your mouth. I'm going to tell you right now. You're going to be hurting. You're not going to be. We're all going to go through things. But you need to be built up in the Lord. Matthew 7, 24 through 27, build on the rock. Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to be a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain descended. The floods came and the winds blew and beat on that house. And it did not fall, for it was founded on that rock. Amen. But everyone who hears these things of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain descended. The floods came and the winds blew and beat on that house. And it fell. And great was its fall. I said, you're able to stand the storms of life. You're standing among Christ, who is your strong tower. That's right. Christ is your strong tower. Isaiah 43, 30-31. I read this the other day. Even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young man shall utterly fall. But those who wait on the Lord, that's right. Are you waiting? Those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Amen. Amen. All right, let me see. I think that's it. All right, praise God. I think that's it. See, so God wants you and I to be strong towers in the days ahead. Let me read you this poem. Jesus Christ is your safe haven. I wrote this just last year, and I've read it before. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. Life is full of storms. With Jesus as our cornerstone, we will not cower. It's time for us Christians to stand up tall. Jesus Christ is our safe haven. We shall not fall. Maybe you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior. Why not give Him a call? Here's a prayer. If you haven't said it, say this prayer. Dear Jesus, I need you. I am sinking. The waters are too deep. Catch me today. I give my heart and life to you. Humbly, I pray. Jesus Christ is there when the winds blow. He will come to your rescue. Remember, Jesus moves real slow. Be not discouraged if He doesn't answer this day. Jesus is there. He did not walk away. Children, be patient and wait. Jesus is faithful. You, my child, will not faint. Amen. Mark 4, 35 through 41. This is from the Contemporary English Version, a storm. That evening, Jesus said to His disciples, Let's cross the east side. So they left the crowd, and His disciples started to cross the lake with Him in the boat. Some of the boats followed along. Suddenly, a windstorm struck the lake. Waves started splashing into the boat, and it was about to sink. Verse 38. Jesus was in the back of the boat with His head on a pillow, and He was asleep. He wasn't worried. He was asleep. His disciples woke Him and said, Teacher, don't you care that we're about to drown? They got all nervous. They were going to drown. Jesus got up and ordered the wind and the waves to be quiet. The wind stopped and everything was calm. Jesus asked the disciples, "Why were you afraid? Don't you have any faith?" Verse 41, "Now they were more afraid than ever and said to each other, 'Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him.'" Praise God. You know, God knows everything. God knows a storm is coming. He knows what's getting ready to happen. We don't need to be afraid. We need to just trust the Lord. And that's for all of us. We're going to pray in a minute. We're going to pray. We're going to pray for our nation. Pray for all of us. I'm going to pray that our declaration song, and then we're going to pray. I have decided. Make your decision today to follow Jesus.
I have decided.
Yes, follow Jesus.
Follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus.
No turning back.
No turning back.
No turning back.
Behind me,
yes,
the cross before me,
yes,
the world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, no turning back, no turning back.
Don't go with me,
don't go with me. Still I will follow, though none go with me. Still I will follow, though none go with me. Still I will follow, no turning back.
There's no turning back.
No turning back.
Make your decision today.
I have decided.
Have you decided?
To follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus.
Yes, make your decision today.
I have decided.
Make your declaration.
Jesus, I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back.
No turning back.
No turning back. Though none go with me, still I will follow.
There's no turning back. And once you make your decision to follow Jesus, you have to follow him. I feel led to say this. I may be speaking right now, and there may be some people listening to me. And maybe your spouse is not willing to make a stand with you. You may have to go alone. You may have to go alone to follow the Lord. It's going to come down to that, saints. It's going to come down to where we have to make a decision. Maybe you're saved. All right? And maybe your spouse is not walking all the way. You have to make a decision whether you're going to follow the Lord or you're not. All right? Because we're all going to answer to God. Every single one of us is going to stand before the Lord and give an account for what we've done in this body. And you can't say, well, they didn't follow you, or my husband and my wife didn't follow you, or my girlfriend, boyfriend. No. God's going to ask you, what did you do? So you have to make a decision today. Whether you fall alone or not. The prayer is up on the screen. If you still have not prayed that prayer, you still haven't given your heart and life to Christ, do it now. Don't wait. I've told you, something is coming. And it's going to affect all of us in this nation. I really feel, and even in other countries, I believe the times are changing. This is a new millennium. We're going to see some things happen. Okay? I know Jesus is coming now. I don't know when. His timing is not ours, but we have to continue to persevere, fight the good fight of faith, and not give up, not turn back, not be like God's wife wanting to go back. No. We got to set our eyes, our face like flint. Not look to the right, look to the left. Look straight ahead. Keep your eyes fixed on Jesus. Know what's happening. Pay attention to the signs. All right? Let me pray before we get ready to leave. Father, I pray for all of us today, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you watch over all of us, Lord. Father, I pray for a hedge of protection over America and over our nation. Keep us all safe, Lord, in Jesus' name, whether we turn to the right or left. I come against that spirit of fear. There's a spirit of fear that may be causing people to be afraid of what's going to happen next, Lord. We don't need to be afraid. We know that you hold our future, Lord. We trust you, Lord Jesus. We pray that President Donald Trump, Father, and the Trump administration would wake up, oh God, and realize that we need you more now than ever, oh God. We pray for our nation, Lord. We pray for those that don't even know you, Lord, that you'd wake them up. Save your people, for these are the last days. Touch our family members that need to know you. Save them, I pray. Thank you for your mercy, your grace, for watching over us, providing every need that we should have, food, water, shelter, our jobs. Lord, we have nothing to worry about. Help us to praise you and thank you in good times and bad, Lord. We're getting ready to see some changes. They're coming quickly. We're already seeing these earthquakes that are happening. Father, you said once more you're going to shake the heavens and earth. Now, we don't know exactly what that means, but Father, we know you're going to do it because you said you're going to do it. And there are those not even listening even now. They're ignoring what the signs, Lord. I pray that we'd pay attention, that you'd wake up the lukewarm churches, Lord, and realize that something big is about to take place, Lord. We don't need to worry, but our hope and trust is in you, Lord. You said we shall do greater miracles, Father, if we believe. Now, Father, we believe. We're about to do greater miracles, Father. Doors are getting ready to open up for your people, Lord. We thank you in advance, Lord. We thank you for what you're getting ready to do. We thank you, Lord. Father, I pray for those that are sick in body today, Lord. Lord, they are so sick. There are those, Lord, they have nowhere else to go, Lord. They're turning to you, Lord God. I speak healing over them right now in Jesus' name. From the top of their head to the soles of their feet, be healed in Jesus' name. Whatever your sickness is, whatever your sickness is, I speak healing over you right now in Jesus' name. For those that are discouraged, Father, I pray that you would encourage our hearts. Let them know that you're there, Lord, that you never leave us and you never forsake us, Father. You're always there. You're always there to help us no matter what we go through. Lord, Father, I pray for those, Father, they may have nowhere else to turn, Lord. Maybe they don't even know you, Lord, and they're wanting to know the truth, Lord. I pray that they'll see this is the truth and that they'll give their hearts and lives to you because it's all about you, Jesus. It's not about us, Father. It's about you, Lord God. I pray for those that may feel discouraged or lonely. Maybe they lost a loved one, Lord. I ask you to help them today. Help them, Father. Lift their heads up, Lord. May they feel your love in Jesus' name. Sense your love, Lord. Know that you're there, Lord. I pray in Jesus' name. We thank you and praise you for this day, Lord. This is the day you have made. We will rejoice and we will be glad. Amen, amen. All right. I want you to know we love you. We appreciate you. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Don't take your eyes off. I'm telling you. Something's about to happen. I keep saying that, but that is what prophetic sermons do. We're to keep warning. All right? There are times I don't want to do this, but this is what the Lord has come to do. Please keep praying for us because we're still going through it, waiting on the Lord, and he's still changing us as he's changing you. He's doing all of us from glory to glory. You know, the fire, he's squeezing us, getting all the impurities out. All right, I think that's it. I want you to know we love you and we appreciate you. And until we meet again, this is Prophetess Dawn O'Brien, servant of the Lord, Dawn's Heartbroken Corner. God bless you. Have a safe and blessed rest of the weekend. Talk to you soon.